Okay, I am back with a new video and I'm going to ramble through this one. Somebody asked me about my passion for the Tarot de Marseille. Marseille type decks. And I think I'm going to start with this one. This one is from Pamela Coleman-Smith, who created the art for Mr. Waite, and Ryder is the company. This is a deck that is from 1909. And I'm not saying that these are the correct colors, but you know, 1909. It's fairly new. It's a new deck with new information. It has illustrated pips. It has, you know, every card shows a scene, which is important and shows you the meaning of the card. Very useful deck, very practical deck. It's a little bit harsh and cruel to the eye, in my opinion. That's because all the primary colors just give me a little bit of a headache. There is a deck that gives me a even worse headache. That is the Thoth deck from Mr. Crowley and Frida Harris, the artist. And I don't have a Thoth deck here, but we probably all know about the Thoth deck. I have two decks that are Thoth-ish. This is the Field Tarot, which has very soft and gentle colors. And I like the cubic style here. We have the titles, the names and titles, the Moon, Sun, Judgment, Universe, Love, Union is the Two of Cups, Friendship is the Three of Cups. So every card has a title, and that is this deck Thoth-ish. Not exactly Thoth, but Thoth-ish. We have here the Urban Tarot. By the way, the Thoth deck is from 1938, 1939, and a little bit later. So the Thoth deck is even newer. We have, again, the number, the card, and the title. Nine is gain. We have Four of Cups is luxury. We have ruin, and so on and so on. This is a beautiful deck. I really like this deck. It's better than using a real Thoth deck that Lady Frida Harris created. So let me put these out of the way. Now I've shown you the most famous tarot decks, the Rider-Waite-Smith and the Thoth. Both are really, really new decks, 1909 and 1938, 1939 up to 1945. A much older deck is, of course, the Italian deck, the Sola Busca, but we have a 400-year-old deck here and here, 400, 300, 200, 100 years old, but these are ancient. These have a long, long history. This is the Golden Tarot of Marseille. It's a glutinous deck, I think. It's bright, it's shiny, it's gold. It's, you know, it makes me feel Christmassy. And as you can see, there are no scenes. There are no illustrations. Well, these are illustrations. Woodblock, to be precise. We also have copper engravings for the, for example, the Etaya decks. Do I have an Etaya deck here? I don't. Here, I have the Etaya decks. But no scenes, no landscape. There is, you know, a baton or wand with a little bit of flower thing going on. Same thing here. The majors and the court cards are people or things like stars and the moon. We have the Two of Coins here. We have the Seven of Swords. So this is what I like. So the first reason that I like Marseille type decks is because of their long history. And of course you can look at books and read the books from Bendov or Jodorowsky or Elias. But you know, they're just giving their point of view, they are giving their opinion, they show us how they would read the cards, but basically there are no rules. This is a custom-made deck, Itarochi Rosenwald, absolutely stunning, gorgeous deck, made for me, and again, there are the court cards, and there are the pips. Pips are non-scenic minors. And we have the majors like Death and Tower and the Fool. And we have a Queen of Coins here. And we have a Queen of Wands here. Oh, this is the Papes. Lovers, Chariots. We have the Fool. So this is art. For me, this is art. So I wanted to show you my favorite, most favorite Marseille deck, but I don't think I have a favorite, to be honest. I will get to the most used in just a bit. Here we have from 1713, Jean-Pierre Payen, and this is a Yves Renaud deck. I had 5 decks from Yves Renaud, but this is the only one that I didn't rehome because I really like to use this deck. Again, this is wood block printing, so it has nothing to do with a pencil and oil paint or watercolor or, you know, wood print. Non-scenic pips. And to me, this is, you know, history. This is part of history. This is important. And what I like the most about this deck, this particular deck, is their facial expressions. A little bit moody, filled with melancholy, a little bit bored or grumpy, zoned out. I don't know. This is just fun. This is a fun deck. And I use it a lot. It's just great. History is important. The fact that there aren't scenic pips gives you a lot of freedom. It gives you a lot of space to use your intuition. If you want to use your intuition and tap into more than just, you know, what's given to you by Crowley or Waite, then this type of deck is just awesome. Also, it gives me a little bit of a demonic vibe. Not this one. This is Old English Tarot. It doesn't mean that it's old. It's just presented to be old. Again, a little bit of scenery here. And most of it is chords, majors and pips. Pip decks. I love pip decks. It gives me a better connection with the divine or the demonic or the angelic. It gives me a better connection with myself. It gives me a better connection with tarot. And I like the dark vibe that it has because there are no rules. If you follow Bendolf or Elias or, you know, some experts on Marseille decks, then you are made to believe and even forced to believe that there are rules. This is an Etaya deck. Etaya, Jean-Baptiste Alliette, was the first to use tarot for fortune telling, the first tarot enthusiast, the first tarot creator. And these are somewhat scenic, but the simplicity again gives me a very raw connection to whatever it is I want to know. We have a wand here, we have some chords, we have nothing to go on, just a couple of titles. And this is based on Etaya, it's Etaro Egyptian. Let me show you a real one. What it really look like. Livre de Toth. We have here Chaos. La Lumière. Les Plantes, Le Ciel. And it tells you the story of creation. And this is also, all these decks, history is important. The dark, demonic vibe that it often gives off, that's important. What also important is that it forces you to blend certain meanings. It forces you to practice conceptual blending and not put one card in one position in one spread. You can probably get better results when you use a 9-box spread, 3, 3, and 3, or complete tableau with majors. Another one is this one, Tarot Emblemata. I did a review about this deck a while back. Very limited information, not too much, nothing at all, just a little blurb here. 8 of Swords is pressed, not oppressed. And we have the Page of Wands. It's about youthful friendship and enthusiasm. So this gives me, it triggers my witchy side. Let's just put it that way. It's for a better connection with the other side. It gives me a better connection with me. It is just better in a lot of ways. So basically, we don't know how people played Tarocchi or Tarot 400 years ago. We can only guess. That makes this deck, this type of deck, perfect. We have another one, Tarot Reincarnation. Gives you the playing cards, the majors. It's a playing card tarot hybrid, where there are majors and you have all the playing cards with animals. And that's it. Sometimes you feel how an animal feels and you can genuinely say that this is beyond the ugly, or sharpness in making decisions. And it's just refreshing to not be bothered with the Rider-Waite-Smith crap, which is tarot made simple, or the Thoth, which is tarot made complicated. Rider-Waite-Smith made tarot easy, and Thoth and Harris made tarot complicated. This is another hybrid-ish deck, Tarot de Marseille of the New Incarnation, that does offer you, scenic pips, but it is very helpful in creating a better understanding of what the miners are about. So I really love this deck. Scenes, people are doing things, working on things. These are the court cards. So this is a beautiful deck that I treasure. Then we have my newest addition to my Tarot de Marseille, Marseille type deck, is the Tarot de Paris. And 17th century, again, an old deck without rules. You can use, of course, the numbers, and you can use the, how do you call these? These are Le Fou, Le Batelier, completely different deck. You can use the minors, as in here we have the Ace, 2, 3, and you know it's coins, so it's earthy, it's worldly matters, it's something down to earth. Here we have emotions, feelings, love. These are the cups. If you know these, then using them for fortune telling or divination makes things a lot easier. And it's raw, it's pure, it's uncomplicated. And these decks aren't meant to become friendly or passionate lovers. These are just raw, I'm not going to fool around. I'm not going to fuck around. I'm not going to mess around with you. You are not going to mess around with me. I'm going to tell you exactly what's going on and what is. And the lack of bullshit is really refreshing. This is my most used deck. And that's what this video is all about. Tarot Renan, Tarot de Marseille. It's a Piatnik deck. This is from 1983. And this one is from 1984. I have another one here. 1945. So there were several printing. It's still not out of print. I don't know what's going on. Here are the majors. Woodblock. It's just insane. I don't know. It's not about me geeking out on a Tarot Marseille type 1, type 2, type 3. And I also think that a lot of academics and historians, you know, make things too complicated. I was part of a Facebook group a long time ago that was all about the Kabbalah in the Tarot de Marseille. I don't think there is Kabbalah in here, you know. But if you want to, of course, you can find things that make you think about Kabbalah. There's no astrology in here. But if you want to, you can probably find something. Historians and academics also go through cards like this. And then they totally get stuck on the fact that this page has his thumb up. And that this leg is white and the other one is gray. And this foot is white and the other one is covered in mud. You know, you want to see, you can find things in this deck that remind you or refer to your own life, but it doesn't have to be there. It's a mystery. How these ended up on paper isn't a mystery, but, you know, the colors and the shapes and the coins and the wands and the swords and, you know, you can find yourself in this deck if you are looking hard enough. And sometimes it comes easy and sometimes it's a shit show. But I also want to show you something else. A very old Italian deck. This is something that I did use a lot, and it's not the Solabusca but a Visconti deck, so a completely different vibe. And this is majors only, something that you see a lot in these old decks, that there are only majors. But I hope this makes a little bit more sense now. The long history is important, and it really draws me to this type of deck. The dark side of this, the mysterious side of this, the foggy side of this is very attractive. The freedom that you get from reading with these decks is absolutely amazing. Here is one cup dominating others. So this can be a group of people or a family member with an elder that decides for the rest of them. Just something. It doesn't mean that I read that card the same every time. So here we have two people that want to break free from restrictions or something. But you can see things in this deck that others can't see, or you can make others see things in this deck that they didn't see before. I hope this makes sense to some or to most. This is cruel, harsh, impossible. I like this deck. I like this deck. This one in particular. That one is very special to me. That one is very special. That one. They're all special to me. But there is something about Pip decks and Marseille style decks that is amazing. So, very long video. Sorry. Apologies. Bye.